The scripture this morning is John 20, 19 to 31. And you can follow along on the back of your bulletin. I'm reading from a little different translation, but it's not that different. On the evening of the first day of the week, when the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. The disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again, Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Now Thomas, called Didymus, was one of the 12 that was not with the disciples when Jesus came. So the other disciples told him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see the nail marks in his hands and put my fingers where the nails were and put my hand into his side, I will not believe it." A week later, his disciples were in the house again, and Thomas was with them. Through the doors were locked, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, "Put your fingers here, see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it into my side. Stop doubting and believing." Thomas said to him, "My Lord and my God." Then Jesus told him, "Because you have seen me, you have believed. Blessed are those who have not seen me and yet believed." Jesus did many other miraculous signs in the presence of his disciples. I think I went too far. No. His disciples, as recorded in this book, these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that maybe believing you may have life in his name.
So that story that Lemoyne just read, you know what the church calls that story? Doubting Thomas. Now, first of all, I don't like that nickname, okay? None of the gospel writers gave him that name. None of them. Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John did not call him Doubting Thomas. It is the church that gave him that awful nickname. Now, you know, have you ever heard anybody refer to Peter as denying Peter or narcissistic John or petty James? No. But Thomas, he gets a label that I'm sorry, he does not deserve. When we refer to him as Doubting Thomas, it makes it look like there is no room for doubt if you want to be in with God. And yet, there is an abundance of people throughout the Bible who started out doubting, who were doubters. And this nickname that we've given Thomas makes it sound as if doubting is the worst possible thing that you can do as a Christian. Oh, what an unfaithful, unbelievable, horrible person Thomas was for doubting the resurrected Christ. Listen, he never doubted the risen Christ. He doubted the disciples who told him about it, right? And if you want to talk about who's not doing what they're supposed to be doing, I'm ready to point the fingers at the rest of those disciples. First of all, they were in a house where they were locked, with the doors closed, locked up, because they feared who? The Jews. Now, I need to make a clarification here. They were not afraid of Jews in general. You got to be real careful with this, because a lot of folks throughout history, and even to this day, take verses like this and use them to justify anti-Semitism. Christians in Germany who supported Hitler during his rise to power often referred to the Jews as the Christ killers. So let me just make this clear. Remember, the disciples were Jews, right? Jesus was a Jew. So here they were, in fear, not of Jews in general, but in fear of the corrupt Jewish leaders who conspired with the Romans to kill Jesus. Don't let anybody ever convince you otherwise, okay? So then, Jesus appeared to these disciples who had gathered there, minus Thomas. And of course, they were happy to see him. You know, these guys were a bunch of goofballs. They were probably saying things like, oh, look at there, Mary Magdalene wasn't crazy after all. Here's Jesus, you know? Oh, that poor woman. And so Jesus comes in and gives them a commission. He says, as the Father sent me, so I send you. And then Jesus did something interesting. He breathed on them, and he said, receive the Holy Spirit. Which makes sense, because all the other gospel writers mention the importance of Jesus giving the Holy Spirit to the disciples before he commissioned them. And so, if you really want to think about it, this is John's version of the Great Commission. I'm giving you my Spirit, and I am sending you out. Okay, sending us out to do what? To forgive sins. Now, wait a minute. Who other than God has the ability to forgive sins? Good question. Because you don't hear too many sermons about this part of the Doubting Thomas story, do you? We may touch on it a bit when we talk about the Lord's Prayer, especially when we choose to translate it as forgive us our sins as we forgive the sins of others, rather than forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. We talk a lot about how Jesus forgives our sins, but we don't say a whole lot about our own power to forgive sins. Maybe it's because we're not very good at it, right? We're rarely even willing to forgive sins. So this is when Thomas enters into the picture, because he missed out on all of this. He missed out on Jesus' commission. He missed out on receiving the Holy Spirit. So when Thomas came back and the other disciples told him about all of this, he made it clear that he only believes what he sees. Oh, there he goes again. There goes Doubting Thomas. Listen, Thomas never asked for anything more than what any other disciples, including Mary Magdalene, had already received. See, Mary, when she went to the tomb, she didn't go to the tomb because she thought Jesus had been raised. She went there to take care of his body. So when she found the empty tomb, she didn't say, oh, Jesus is gone, so that must mean he's been raised from the dead. Because even when Jesus came and spoke to her, she didn't recognize him. She didn't know who it was. And she was asking him, sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've laid him. But then it finally dawned on her that this was Jesus. And then she put it all together, and then she believed. Oh, but not Thomas. No, he doesn't have an excuse. He's the doubter, after all. He didn't buy this story that they encountered Jesus and that Jesus gave them his Spirit and commissioned them to forgive sins, because they've given Thomas no reason for him to believe that they, as disciples, have been transformed or changed. And the best evidence that there's been zero transformation on the disciples' part? They were still hiding in the room with the room locked a week later. Jesus, come on, guys, what are you still doing in the house? Jesus sent you out. He gave you the Holy Spirit. He equipped you so that you can go and do what he told you to do. What are you still doing in the house with the doors shut and locked? Thomas must have been like, really? Jesus came back, huh? Doesn't seem like you're any different. 8 days later, and it still didn't seem like there was much evidence that they'd been transformed. It is no wonder Thomas doubted. Those other disciples had a whole week to get moving on the mission that Jesus gave them. As the Father sent me, so I send you. Again, doesn't look like it. Doesn't look like they've been out forgiving any sins. So, before you start giving Thomas unflattering nicknames, let's not forget that we could call this whole crew of disciples a bunch of scaredy cats, if you want to go throwing nasty names out there, right? But then, on that eighth day, Jesus had this famous encounter that he had with Thomas where he showed him the wounds in his hand and in his side, and then Thomas finally believed. And then Jesus said, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen, yet have come to believe." And anyone who's been in the church for any number of years has probably heard a dozen sermons on that particular verse right there. But if you haven't figured it out already, I'm tired of all the negative attention that we direct against poor Thomas. And what a jerk he was because he couldn't believe what the other disciples said unless he saw for himself. Why don't we give the guy credit for just staying with the disciples in the first place? Because when the disciples told him about seeing Jesus, he could have said, "Y'all are full of beans," and then just went home. But he didn't. Being there is 90% of the struggle. He was there. So let's give the guy props for hanging in there with his friends in spite of his doubts. Let's give him credit for hanging out with the disciples when clearly they were still too afraid to go outside the house, even though Jesus told them to go out and forgive sins. So, what's the real lesson here, Jesse? Well, here's what I think is the bigger lesson in the story, and it's a tougher lesson to understand because the easy thing to do is pick on Thomas and call him names and saying that he lacked faith or commitment. See, I think this story has more to do with the core value of God's kingdom. It is about Jesus preparing his followers to usher in the kingdom of God. This was Jesus' ministry and message. He said that the kingdom of God is at hand. Meaning right here, right in front of us. So close, but yet so far, because you just can't get beyond seeing the world through the filters of Earth's kingdom. See, God's reign is different. The kingdom of God isn't just for brave people. It's for folks who are scared. Scared, but still willing to become brave by hanging in there. Even when we doubt. God's kingdom isn't just for the good people. God's kingdom isn't just for those folks who are always paragons of faithfulness, who trust and obey because there's no other way. It's for normal, flawed people like you and me, like doubting Thomas, or denying Peter, or narcissistic John, or petty James, or the one guy who the Gospels did give a negative nickname to, Simon the Zealot. Because in our day and age, we'd call him Simon the crazy redneck survivalist militia guy. Either way, it doesn't matter because even Simon the crazy redneck survivalist militia guy has a place in God's kingdom too. And I got to say this because I only touched on it a little bit last week, but God's kingdom isn't just for men either. We sort of made a joke about how the church rewarded Mary Magdalene for being the first evangelist by making sure women kept silent in the church for the next 2,000 years. Let us not forget that gender makes no difference either as far as who can live under the safety and protection of God's reign. You might think, "Oh, come on, Jesse, that's a given. This is the 21st century. You would be surprised, exactly, huh? There's a term for what happened on that day when Jesus appeared to Thomas and those other disciples, and we call it fellowship. If you read the language that the Bible was written in, if you read the Greek, the word is koinonia. Koinonia is what we translate fellowship. So now you know why we call that room on the other end of this building, Koinonia Hall, because it's a place where we gather for fellowship. Fellowship is all about belonging. And it's the kind of belonging that isn't based on status or achievement, behavior, gender, education, race, orientation, culture, fashion, generation, political affiliation, nothing like that. Fellowship is based on a deep belief that everyone matters. Everyone is welcome. And everyone is loved. No conditions, no expectations, no exemptions. It's not the kind of belonging that you find at the top of the ladder among those who think that they're the best. In fact, a lot of the time, it's at the bottom, among all the rest, with all the other failures and losers who have either climbed the ladder and fallen or who never got enough gumption to get up on the ladder in the first place. Whatever else this reign of God will become, from that night on, it was a fellowship. It's a community where anyone who wants to be part of it will be welcome. Jesus showed his scars, which means we don't have to hide ours. Fellowship is for scarred people and scared people. It's for people who want to believe but just aren't sure how to believe. When we come together, just as we are, we begin to rise again like Jesus, like the Easter people that we are called and claimed to be. We come together to believe again, to hope again, to live again. Through fellowship, a little locked room becomes the biggest space in the world. And in that space of fellowship, the Holy Spirit fills us up like a deep breath of fresh air.